Camberwell, and it's a pleasure if you're watching online. We welcome you especially. Put your feet up, enjoy a cup of coffee while we sit here without one. But that's okay. We'll look forward to one later. Every generation of Christians has looked forward to the second coming of Christ. At Easter, as we enter through Lent and look forward to Palm Sunday, we, of course, also remember and welcome the first coming of Christ. Today, later on, we'll be reading God's Word in Mark 13, which will give us a bird's eye view of the purpose of the first and second coming of Christ. Indeed, what we see throughout every generation, as far back as the psalmist, is that every generation there has been those who worship the true and living God. In fact, Psalm 102, 12 to 17 tells us, "But you, O Lord, will sit on your throne forever. Your fame will endure to every generation. You will arise and have mercy on Jerusalem. And now is the time to pity her. Now is the time you promised to help. For your people love every stone in her walls and cherish even the dust in her streets. Then the nations will tremble before the Lord. The kings of the earth will tremble before his glory. For the Lord will rebuild Jerusalem. He will appear in his glory. He will listen to the prayers of the destitute. He will not reject their pleas." Let us stand as we indeed exalt this Christ, our Lord Jesus, the name high over all. Let us stand and sing.
Just before we continue our time of worship, I want to take the opportunity to tell you what's happened this week in the youth of Camberwell. On Friday night, we had a combined youth service in Dandenong, and we had 55 youth come along, and the biggest group of that was from Camberwell, which is awesome.
Woo! Yeah.
I thought I'd mention it because the first song we are going to sing together today is Our Redeemer. And it's one of the songs we actually played on Friday night. So if you hear loud voices coming from the back, hopefully that's the youth. But please remain standing and join us in singing Our Redeemer.
Our Redeemer.
Jesus, I trust. Our future and hope, the hope of the world, we claim His territory now. So break into song, we cry out aloud, and open our hearts to what the Lord is doing now. So don't be ashamed, don't be afraid.
Fill this room with the Holy Spirit. Allow us to open the eyes of our hearts and look to you, Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, our Savior. I pray that as we continue this time, you will really speak to us today. Amen.
See you.
will now bring us their message, followed by the tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Wasn't that lovely? Oh, not quite on. Wasn't that lovely, everyone? Was that lovely? It was. It's time for the tithes and offerings now, and they're going to be taken up by our explorers. So a special big thank you to all the people who help out in explorers every week. We really value what you do and the way you work with our kids. But explorers, if you guys want to get up with your little offering bags and run around now and take up your tithes and offerings, then we'll be up for the announcements. Thank you, Emily. Lovely job. Excellent work. Ezra said to me, I've got $40. It's like, that's awesome. That is awesome. So it's nice private giving. So announcements for today. First of all, hello if you're new to Camberwell. Hello online, folks. And hello to Shireen, who's watching online as well. She's not here today. We have some announcements today. The first one would be that if you're new to our church, thanks for visiting us today. We'd love to have your details and, you know, be able to contact you and just see how you're travelling and make you a part of this wonderful faith community. I think that's a very good thing to do if you'd like to. That'd be great. You can come and see me. You can see Dean. You can see Darren. You can see anyone, really. And they'll go... go and see Alan. So that's pretty good. Also, too, if you are an existing member of our church, we're just towards the end now of completing the updating the hub with everyone's details. We've had some people hand in their written hard copy forms down at the back to Yvette today, which is great. So if you want to do it online, you can do it online. You can scan a QR code. You can jump on YouTube and you can pause at this point. Just messing with you. You can pause at this point and you can scan that because that's also up on the screen on the YouTube clip as well. Or you can go and see Yvette and she can give you a hard copy to fill in with something called a pen. It's very cool. All right. And next one is... We start to hit our Easter series. And so next Sunday is Palm Sunday. So today is our self-denial, of course, but next Sunday is Palm Sunday. So come along. Yeah, turn your eyes to the coming king. You'll see that there's an I theme that runs through, I theme that runs through all of our Easter messages this year. So we're hoping that you can see the point to that. Okie dokie. Maundy Thursday. If you would still like to, we were going to have the closing for the kebabs and the dinner that we all have together. We were going to have that closing today, but there is still some spaces. So we're going to have that officially close as of next Sunday. So if you're keen to come along, shoot Yvette an email or just go up to her today and say, hey, Yvette, Really keen on having some beautiful lamb together as a group. That's awesome. Then, of course, it takes us into Good Friday. And turn your eyes to the cross. Our Good Friday service is at 10 o'clock in the morning. So 10 o'clock. So we'll see you here at 10 o'clock then. Of course, that's where the cross comes in and we have all that wonderful thing that we really, we just love that at Camberwell here. And then the Sunday, of course, Easter Sunday, which is what we like to call Even Better Sunday. I'm just so glad you're here down the front. Like just, you just, nothing from the rest of you. Just, and then the hecklers over there. It's nice. Yeah, that's it. Muppet Show, Waldorf and Statler. And then turn your eyes from fear. And that's a 10 o'clock service on the 31st. That's our good Easter Sunday service. And before it is, I sit down. You might have seen a small, beautiful child standing at the front selling some cookies to raise for her self-denial box. All the kids have got involved in that in my family. And last time when I got up and announced that she was going to do that this Sunday, gold coin donation, I did it in Indonesian and she did the translation. Well, today I'm going to read the English and she's going to do the Indonesian. So please come and buy some of my self-denial cookies.
Can you self-denial crust?
Jika.
Jika Kwenya, self-denial crust.
Gold coin donation.
Salakan Aya.
Thank you.
Chicken Kashi.
Terima kasih, that's not bad. Now, I did say that she was translating what I just said, but she wasn't really. What she was actually saying was, I was saying, please come and buy some self-denial cookies, gold coin donation out there. And then what she was saying in Indonesian is, if these self-denial cookies are too hard, blame Dad. So I hope you enjoy the rest of the service. Thank you for all you do in terms of the self-denial. People give of their time, people give of their wallets. But I think it's wherever it comes from, we really appreciate the fact that we're looking beyond just simply our community with this. We're looking to the Philippines. We're looking to Indonesia. We're looking to Fiji. And we're there and we're doing... This money goes towards helping ventures that actually will change people's lives for the better. We are so privileged in the country that we live in that we can come every Sunday, we can worship, we can do things that help the community. This is taking that goodness that we've been given and placing it directly into the hands of people who need it. So I think we're heading to a self-denial video now, I believe. So thank you, everyone. Have a lovely rest of the service. You can sit down.
As Alan said, we're now moving into that time of the self-denial appeal. And the self-denial appeal, as many of you know, it's an annual appeal. This is the way that the Salvation Army gives to other Salvation Army entities in developing countries. And over the last 5 weeks, we've been challenged as we've watched how the money that we give goes to different needs in different countries. And so once again, we have this opportunity to put our love in action through giving to the self-denial appeal. And so as the music plays on the screen, I invite you to come and to give sacrificially once again this morning.
Jesus, let your love shine through us, or let it lead to action. Where there is a need, be your hands and feet, fan into flame a passion. We'll be right back. only Son came down from heaven to pay the price that only you could do. Your sacrifice brought us together.
Thank you once again for your generosity and encouraging to see that this way that we give is not just something for the adults, it's for all ages, and it's encouraging to see so many money boxes as well, and that our children give to the self-denial appeal. Just as all over the Salvation Army world, everybody gives to one another so that we can see the love of Christ spread throughout the world. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you. Well, I thank you for these wonderful people who once again have given sacrificially to the work of the Salvation Army in developing countries. We pray that as the money is dispersed, that there will be much wisdom in the giving, that we would see a renewed earth, a renewed world, a renewed people, just by us giving today. Be in all that takes place from this point onwards, we pray, Lord, that we would continue to see your army grow, people come to faith in you, and churches built and established. Bless the ministry and the work of your church, we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, just before the Bible message, there was one more announcement, and since Alan stole my thunder previously with the introduction to the self-denial appeal, I will steal his thunder. He's gone anyway. Tonight, oh, there he is. Tonight, if I've got this correctly, at 6 p.m. at Box Hill, there's a worship event that, and see Matt Reeve for more details. So I think it's been put on by the Mission Department, but hosted by Box Hill. So that's 6 o'clock tonight, and everyone is welcome. Now for the Bible reading this morning, Mark chapter 13, and I'm commencing at verse 1, and I'm reading all the way through the 37 verses. And during the week, I went to Officers' Fellowship, which was just out of Ballarat, so just under 2 hours there. And so as I was driving, I was listening to podcasts. And one of the podcasts that I listened to was based on this chapter of Mark 13. And the podcast went for an hour and 10 minutes. So we look forward to Dean preaching and seeing if he can just bring it down. Just a couple of minutes. It's a tough reading. It's a tough theme in some aspects too. But as we read through, take from what Jesus is saying for you. How does this relate for you and for your life? Verse 1. As Jesus was leaving the temple that day, one of his disciples said, "Teacher, look at these magnificent buildings. Look at the impressive stones in the walls." Jesus replied, "Yes, look at these great buildings, but they will be completely demolished. Not one stone will be left on top of another." Later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives across the valley from the temple. Peter, James, John, and Andrew came to him privately and asked him, "Tell us, when will all this happen? What sign will show us that these things are about to be fulfilled?" Jesus replied, "Don't let anyone mislead you, for many will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah. They will deceive many, and you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in many parts of the world as well as famines. But this is only the first of the birth pains with more to come. When these things begin to happen, watch out. You will be handed over to the local councils and beaten in the synagogues. You will stand trial before governors and kings because you are my followers. But this will be your opportunity to tell them about me, for the good news must first be preached to all nations. But when you are arrested and stand trial, don't worry in advance about what to say. Just say what God tells you at that time, for it is not you who will be speaking, but the Holy Spirit. A brother will betray his brother to death. A father will betray his own child, and children will rebel against their parents and cause them to be killed. And everyone will hate you because you are my followers. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. The day is coming when you will see the sacrilegious object that causes desecration standing where he should not be. And then in brackets, reader, pay attention. Then those in Judea must flee to the hills. A person out on the deck of a roof must not go down into the house to pack. A person out in the field must not return even to get a coat. How terrible it will be for pregnant women and for nursing mothers in those days. And pray that your flight will not be in winter. For there will be greater anguish in those days than at any time since God created the world. And it will never be so great again. In fact, unless the Lord shortens that time of calamity, not a single person will survive. But for the sake of his chosen ones, he has already shortened those days. Then if anyone tells you, "Look, here is the Messiah," or "There he is," don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will rise up and perform signs and wonders so as to deceive, if possible, even God's chosen ones. Watch out. I have warned you about this ahead of time. At that time, after the anguish of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will give no light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then everyone will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with great power and glory. And he will send out his angels to gather his chosen ones from all over the world, from the furthest ends of the earth and heaven. Now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its branches bud and its leaves begin to sprout, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see all these things taking place, you can know that his return is very near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will not pass from the scene before all these things take place. Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will never disappear. However, no one knows the day or hour when these things will happen, not even the angels in heaven or the Son himself. Only the Father knows. And since you don't know when that time will come, be on guard. Stay alert. The coming of the Son of Man can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip. When he left home, he gave each of his slaves instructions about the work they were to do. And he told the gatekeeper to watch for his return. You too must keep watch, for you don't know when the master of the household will return, in the evening, at midnight, before dawn, or at daybreak. Don't let him find you sleeping when he arrives without warning. I say to you what I say to everyone, watch for him. And may God give us understanding of his word this morning.
Jesus' farewell prophecy. Why do Christians believe in the second coming? Why is it that every generation of Christians have believed in the second coming, despite the fact that 2,000 years have gone by and he still hasn't returned? Well, Mark 13 provides a bird's eye view of Jesus' two comings and their joint relevance to us as God's people. Here, he predicts with stunning accuracy a number of signs or events that will happen within the disciples' lifetimes, leading up to the end of Israel as a nation in 70 AD. Of course, God wasn't finished with them yet, but that's officially when that happened in that period of history. Jesus then goes on to predict that there will be similar signs happening leading up to the end of the age, the end of the world, when he comes for the second time. Now, the reading in Mark 13 starts with Jesus leaving the temple that day and one of his disciples being rather impressed by the temple building. Teacher, look at these magnificent buildings. Look at the impressive stones and walls. Now, it is true that the temple was considered one of the great wonders of the Roman world. This was not Solomon's temple, nor the one built when Ezra and Nehemiah returned, but a brand new temple. It was commenced about 20 years before Christ was born and was finished about 34 years after Jesus died. Built by Herod's family, it was to be the biggest and the best they ever had in the holy city. Massive stones made up the temple, which was about 490 meters wide, about 270 meters broad, and 9 stories high, with walls as thick as 5 meters in some places. Some of the stones were as big as a bus. Incredible engineering feat. Now, Herod, who was the Roman governor, did this to get the Jews on side. He built them a marvelous temple. He knew this was close to their hearts. He wanted to politically get them on side. And indeed, he did. Its spectacular location on Mount Moriah gave it a rather imposing dominance over ancient Jerusalem. Now, what we don't quite pick up, even from pictures like this one, is that from a distance, it looked like a mountain of gold, because its 9 massive gates and much of its exterior was plated in gold and silver. The great bronze gate alone was worth more than any of the other gates. And so, in response to the positive impression by one of the disciples to Jesus, Jesus replies with something rather astonishing. He says, "Do you see these great buildings? There will not be left there one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." Now, Jesus' words were tragically true. We know soon after Jesus ascended. In fact, in 66 AD, there was amongst the Jews finally an uprising against the Romans who had dominated them for so long. The Jews had had enough and they decided to rise up. And the mighty Roman Empire sent in one of their most brutal leaders, Titus, in 70 AD to quell the rebellion, to subdue the city of Jerusalem. And Titus ordered his soldiers to preserve this beautiful temple. But alas, one of the soldiers in his zeal started a fire which absolutely gutted the whole structure. And as a result, we know from history, from extra-biblical resources, that Titus ordered the whole city and temple to be razed to the ground, a task especially carried out in respect to the temple as soldiers pulled the stones apart in an attempt to reclaim the melted gold. In that generation, Jesus' words had become literally true. This was Jesus' last time leaving the temple precincts before he died. The cross awaited him. And the message he gives his disciples on the Mount of Olives formed a fitting bridge to Jesus' final days. It was his final address, his farewell prophecy. First of all, it was a farewell to the age of the Jews, riveted by his astounding prophecy about the temple. The inner circle of disciples, made up of Peter, James, and John, with the addition of Peter's brother Andrew, they sought a private audience with Jesus nearby on the Mount of Olives. Now, we should remember that it was on this very mount that the Shekinah glory of God, remember the pillar of fire by day and the pillar of cloud by night? Or was it the other way around? The pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night, the mighty presence of God represented by that cloud. Well, the great Shekinah glory had departed from the temple 600 years before, according to Ezekiel 11. And it would be upon the Mount of Olives that Zechariah prophesied that when Messiah came, he would split the mountain in two upon his return in the last judgment. And this was the place where Jesus has this final message to give to his disciples. Rising about 50 meters above the holy city of Jerusalem, the mountain afforded a dramatic view of the temple, a little bit like the one we're looking at now. So there, with the ivory and gold temple lying below them, the disciples asked Jesus the question, "Tell us, when will these things be? What will be the sign when all these things are about to be accomplished?" In other words, what would be the time and the signs that would precede the destruction of the temple? And then Jesus gives them a very clear answer. But his answer would go beyond their lifetime and would speak to the church as a whole in the ages to come. We shall also see that Jesus was not particularly interested in setting dates or giving details about dates, but rather in encouraging his own disciples to be steadfast and faithful until he returns. Jesus said in verse 30, after he'd shared all the details of what was to come, he says something that's a bit perplexing to many. He said, "This generation will not pass from the scene before all these things have taken place." You may say, well, Jesus didn't come again in the life of the disciples. So what does this mean? You could get confused reading this passage if you think that this refers to both the end of the age of the Jewish nation as it was then in AD 70, as well as the second coming. But it helps us to see that Jesus brings together both the coming judgment, the end of the age for the Jews in 70 AD, and his second coming after the church age at the end of the age for all people. The Old Testament prophets were like this. They saw the coming of Messiah, but they never really saw two comings. They saw one. They saw two mountain peaks of the same thing. And Jesus does the same with the events of the coming judgment, the end of the age for the Jews in 70 AD, and his second coming at the end for all people. So we can only see the mountain peaks, not the valley in between, what we would call the church age, which has gone on for 2,000 years so far. Jesus talked about the events of his second coming and his first coming as if they were one, as did the Old Testament prophets. And so this passage appears to be mixed up, and you think, well, how could it be that this generation will not pass before all these things take place? But in fact, Jesus was saying, there is an end of the age for the Jews. There is an end of that period of my first coming when these things would be fulfilled. But then they'll be fulfilled yet again as we lead up to the second coming. Similar things, similar signs will be seen. Jesus accurately then predicts a number of events coming in the next 40 years to the holy city that he had no possible way of influencing their fulfillment, particularly because by the time they started to be fulfilled literally, he was gone. He was gone to God. We see in verses 5 to 12 these coming events. We see that he talked about false messiahs coming in his day. And indeed, we know as we look back, the Bar Kokhba uprising and other Jews rose up and said they were the Messiah. But alas, they died in the midst of the battles. There would be wars and rumors of wars, Jesus said. And war was constant then. And of course, war remains to this day. We see it mirrored in our own age. In fact, the historian Durant wrote these words. He said, war is one of the constants of history and has not diminished with civilization and democracy. He calculated that in the last 3,421 years of recorded history, only 268 have seen no war. And they are the wars we know about in recorded history. Another historian thought that perhaps there had been, since recorded history, no more than 300 days of peace in the world where there was no war. Wars and rumors of wars, Jesus said, would come. Famines, in verse 8, and after the fall of Jerusalem, many, of course, died of starvation. And earthquakes, verse 8. We know that there were earthquakes in Jesus' death when he died. There was an earthquake. And indeed, we see that sign was very clear to the disciples around Jesus' death. And he said that in our day too, the days leading up to his next coming, there would be earthquakes and that they would increase. Now, you may ask the logical question. Yes, it seems like earthquakes have increased, but perhaps we're just measuring them now. Perhaps we have the technology and we're just measuring quakes. And of course, it appears that in the last 100 years, there are more earthquakes than previously in history. Wouldn't you like to ask a seismologist that question? Yes? Well, I'm glad you thought of that because I did. In fact, a friend of mine, Dr. David Love, a good Christian name really, isn't it? Good name for a Christian, David Love. He is the senior seismologist in the Geological Survey of South Australia. He was a member of my church and he confirmed to me he was well aware of these prophecies. And I asked him this question. I said, but isn't it just that we're measuring them now? He was adamant. He said, no. We know from geology and from various other means scientifically that earthquakes are more frequent now than previously in human history. Now, he didn't give me all the science backing that up at the time, but he was adamant that that was the case. I think I'm willing to listen to a scientist like him rather than my best guess at it. Persecution was the other sign that Jesus said would happen. We know that persecution was very much a part of the picture in the first 30 years of church history. We see the book of Acts recording this. And today we know that persecution is common still. In fact, there are more Christian martyrs today than there ever have been in any other generation. Now, all of these things that Jesus predicted to happen before 70 AD, before the destruction of the temple, and continue happening today, all of Jesus' predictions became literally true in the first 40 years. It's not like listening to Nostradamus, where you get a vague prophecy and you sort of, you know, work it out somehow to sound like something that happened in history and say, see, Nostradamus was an incredible prophet. Jesus was very specific. His prophecies were very specific about what would happen in Jerusalem, in the holy city, in that 40-year period. And he described all of those elements. We see too that here we have suddenly a faith that is not a leap in the dark. Sometimes atheists to a scientist accuse Christians, they build a straw man by saying that Christians, you know, we just have a strong feeling about it. We just have faith is just an emotion. It's a feeling. It's an idea you ascend to. It's not evidence-based. It's not based in history or reality. It's just something that comforts the weak. Well, I'm sorry, Christianity has never taught that that is the Christian faith. That is an atheist's misconception of the Christian faith. We have a faith based in history, in time and space. Unlike any other major religion of the world, ours is based in historical events in time and space. We do our religion in the body. It happens at this level. It is indeed evidence-based. So far from being an illogical leap into the dark, faith for these disciples turns out to be something evidence-based, as we like to say today. But let me share one other fact that was stunning for the disciples in Jesus' prophecies about what was coming. Here's another stunning historical fact that was fulfilled very literally. Now, bear with me on this, but you know where Jesus says, the day is coming when you will see, he says to the disciples, the sacrilegious object that causes destruction standing where he should not be. Now, Mark puts, the translators put it in brackets, but Mark emphasizes, he says, reader, pay attention. Now, what other verse do you know of where the writer of the gospel says, now, reader, pay attention? It seems to me that we need to really pay attention to this. What does this mean? Well, in another translation, it talks about the abomination of desolation. That's another way of talking about it. And Jesus said, when you see that thing happen, get right out of Jerusalem. Literally, get out, flee. Now, you and I may not be familiar with the term abomination of desolation, or the phrase is sacrilegious object that causes desecration standing where he should not be. But the listeners of that message, these disciples, they understood perfectly what Jesus meant. Why? Because in Daniel 9:27 and three places altogether, this abomination of desolation is described by Daniel. And better than that, they had had a recent historical fulfillment of that in their previous generation. About the year 200 years prior to Christ was the Maccabean period, between the Old and New Testament periods. And before the Romans invaded, the Greeks came in and invaded Jerusalem. And the Greeks came and put the statue of Zeus in the temple. And they sacrificed an unclean animal, a pig, right there on the altar. Why? Just to totally annoy the Jews. It was a desecration, a sacrilegious object that causes desecration, standing where it should not be. Literally, there was a sacrifice of a pig, but worse, there was the god Zeus standing in the temple. Now, understand this, that Mark's gospel was written about 64 AD, prior to the destruction of the temple. Just before 66 AD, when the Jewish rebellion brought the Romans legions in with Titus. So Christians knew and were familiar with Jesus' prophecy, and when in 70 AD Titus brought Roman legions to conquer the uprising, they saw also that he had brought not only his soldiers and his troops, but they had brought with them the many idols that the Romans acknowledged. In all the lands they conquered, they would set up a temple and they would have representing the different idols of the different places that they had conquered. They had the different gods ready to set up in the temple. The Christians and the Jews directly went to these words from Daniel, and in the case of the Christians, the words of Jesus, that when you see the sacrilegious object that causes desecration standing where it should not be, flee, get out of Jerusalem, Jesus said. So Christians knew these prophecies. They remembered Jesus' prophecy about this, and all of the Christians fled Jerusalem immediately and were saved. Now this, the extra biblical resources that we have, texts, historical texts and writers outside of the Bible, like Josephus, who lived just after Christ was born, died, he was around, and he wrote this history up. So did the second century historian Ariston and later Eusebius. They recorded these events as literally happening, that the Jews fled immediately. Now, Titus, in his mercy, stood there with his legions on the outskirts of the holy city and stood there with his idols ready to install them in the temple. And he said, "You've got a few weeks to get out. Go if you want to, but we've come to quell the rebellion. We've come to take over the holy city." The Christians at that juncture fled immediately, and history records they were all saved. There was not one Christian killed in the confrontation. We know from Josephus and other sources that the Christians went across the Jordan River. They walked about 120 kilometers to a town called Pella. We even know where they settled. And according to the Jewish historian Josephus, the Jews, however, did the opposite to what the Christians did. The Christians fled immediately, but the Jews from all around the countryside came in to the holy city thinking they would be protected. I hesitate to tell you of the pains and the trauma of those days in the holy city. The Romans and Jewish historians recorded that there was about 1.1 million Jews were killed by the sword or by famine, just as Jesus had predicted. According to Roman statistics, 97,000 Jews were taken to Rome as slaves in 70 AD. Do you remember that Jesus told his disciples to pray? Not that the fall of Jerusalem would not happen, but pray it won't happen in the winter for the sake of the mothers and their children. And indeed, it didn't come in the winter. But during those terrible days, person after person rose up among the Jews and claimed to be the Messiah, but alas, all of those who claimed that perished. And this brings us to our last point today, that Jesus, when he left the temple for good, and he knew the cross awaited him, the Mount of Olives prophecy formed a fitting bridge to Jesus' final days. It was his final address. It was his farewell prophecy. He was about to die and to rise and to bring in the new creation. He was about to bring in the promise of new life and a new creation, and one day a new holy city that God himself would rebuild. And to return to the question we started with, why is it that every generation of Christians have believed in the second coming, despite the fact that it's been 2,000 years? Why have they believed? These disciples of Jesus, Peter, James, John, Peter's brother Andrew, were so convinced of Jesus' second coming. Why? Because they saw in their lifetime the literal physical fulfillment of these prophecies of Jesus in their generation. They lived to see them fulfilled. The early Christians and Christians ever since have not believed in the second coming just because Jesus said it would happen. They have believed because of his first coming and all that happened in his first coming. They believed because there were eyewitnesses of Jesus having died and been buried and been raised up on the third day at Easter. And as the years progressed, not only had the disciples firsthand seen the resurrected Lord, the one who had fulfilled Old Testament prophecy and come as the chosen Messiah of God, had died for the sins of the world, had been raised again from the dead, had utterly defeated the powers of darkness. Not only had they seen these miraculous events, but then as their mission went on, they progressively saw the fulfillment of these very accurate prophecies by Jesus in that 40 years. They literally came true. And they came to the logical, evidence-based conclusion that if his prophecies are true, then his promises are too. Someone say hallelujah. Jesus therefore comforted and prepared his disciples for this day. He said in John 14, 27, he said, I leave behind with you peace. I give you my own peace, and my gift is nothing like the peace of this world. You must not be distressed. You must not be daunted. You have heard me saying, I am going away, but I am coming back to you. If you really love me, you would be glad, because I am going to my Father, for my Father is greater than I. And I have told you of it now, before it happens, so that when it does happen, your faith in me will not be shaken. All of these things together convince them to believe in all of his promises to them, to the point that these disciples were willing to die for that truth. We know that the receivers of this message, bar one, were probably martyred a martyr's death and gave their lives for these great truths. That Jesus' prophecies are true, and so are his promises of salvation. Alastair was one that survived all of these events of the end of the age of the Jews and entered into the church age, looking forward to the second coming. And this was John. In about 100 AD, he wrote these words. 1 John 3:2, "Dear friends, we are already God's children, but he has not yet shown us what we will be like when Christ appears. But we do know that we will be like him, for we will see him as he really is." Friends, this impulse to long for the coming of our Lord is not about finding tricky ways to see the fulfillment in the newspaper of prophecy. It's because the credibility of Christ, the greatest prophet of all, has come as the great priest of all, as the sacrificial lamb. And this is why this chapter is an essential part of the Easter story. Let us pray. After thousands of years of history, Lord, our world should be better than this. Yet here we are facing wars and rumors of wars, nation rising against nation and kingdom against kingdom, famines, earthquakes, persecution, false prophets deceiving many, lawlessness abounding, and love growing cold, just as Jesus predicted. Jesus, who died for our world and will one day reign over its empires, in his name we ask, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. May your word spread among the nations May your name be exalted. Give us leaders who fear you. Give us missions instead of misery, hope instead of despair, food and water where there is hunger and thirst, peace where there is war. Bring healing to the diseased, then freedom to the oppressed, and hasten the day when the kingdoms of this world will become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. Amen. Amen. Let us stand together and let us sing that wonderful hymn, "Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory." Let us sing together. Who is able to keep you from falling away and bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. All glory to him who alone is God, our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord. All glory, majesty, power, and authority are his before all time and in the present and beyond all time. Amen.